Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. We hope out there you're sanitizing. We hope you're wearing your distancing. Because COVID-19 is still ravaging our society and it is real and it does kill. Now, we all understand that COVID-19 pandemic has shone light on the need of the African insurance sector to show its critical role in supporting people and businesses. To discuss business and risks on The Checkpoint tonight is the Chief Executive Officer of the Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda, Alhaj Ibrahim Lubega Kadnabi. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Haji, to kickstart our show, can you help us understand what the portfolio of insurance business is in our economy?
Thank you very much, and I would like to say good evening to our viewers. Also, I want to say that, as you said, whether we are sanitizing, indeed we are, and it is only that now I've been requested to remove my mask that I have too, but I want to say that the insurance industry in Uganda has grown at a very promising rate, and indeed this is a double-digit percentages which has been given, which has given us really promise and confidence that it is on the steady progress. You may need to note that as we closed 2019 calendar year, and that is January to December, the industry had underwritten premiums close to 975 billions, which is really very good, and indeed it was promising. Our hope is that 2020, even though there was COVID, we have bypassed the 1 trillion mark in underwritten premiums. That is a very impressive development, and it is indeed ensuring that we are moving on the positive and the right direction.
What would you anchor this progress on?
There are many factors which we attribute this development to, and one of them is, first of all, as a regulator, we have made our presence felt. We have made sure that we have indeed held discussions with the players. We have looked at the issues which were undermining the growth of the insurance industry in Uganda, and we have addressed them. Indeed, if any player does not respect what he promised a client, that can be a reason for us to internally fight. But the good news is that the players are also responsive. None of the players is not doing what we agreed. We have seen that as a regulator, we have gone out to the public to educate them more about what insurance is and why indeed we take up insurance. We are happy that the public is responsive also for those we have given the information, and indeed those who have visited our website, they have responded positively. And what are we saying? We are only saying that whoever has anything of value, please get interested in ensuring its safety. As you strive to make your money, strive to safeguard your money. And who safeguards your money and your assets? It is insurance, because insurance is there to do that job. And we used to hear people thinking of insurance as a last resort. And what I can tell them, if they are valuing whatever they have sweated for it is important that they also look at insurance as a first course of, to run to safeguard it.
You prove me right if I'm wrong. Largely the Ugandan society is unbanked. How have you been able to convince a largely unbanked society into buying into insurance?
Indeed, this problem is in many developing countries. You may need to realize that many of our people do not bank, but they also do not insure majorly, because what we have realized that in many of the developed economies, insurance is taking a very big share of contributing to the economy. But you realize that in Uganda also, because many of our people are in the informal sector, they have also not banked money, but they have also not insured their assets. However, the good news is that that is slowly changing. We have tried to do what is expected of us, and indeed is making sure that the products which are put on the market do respond to the needs of the industry. And that has greatly changed what has been done. And the micro insurance products, there are many insurance products which address the needs of the people who work in the markets. There are many insurance products which now address the people who are in the agriculture sector. There are many products and many ways we have tried to reach out to the individuals by way of selling and by way of paying for premiums. And that has been done through the initiatives like the bank assurance initiatives, like the mobile platforms which we use now to pay many of the insurance policies for. And I can say that even the funeral products which are on the market, people are responding positively, and we are happy as the regulator.
Initially you talked of a double digit growth to a tune of over 900 billion, right? For clarity, help us paint a picture of this growth from what and in which years to where we are now.
What I can say is in 2011, when I took over as a CEO of the Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda, the industry was underwriting about 240 billion a year. And that changed when I took over, and we saw 290 billion, we went to 320, and that has now been growing steadily at an average of about 13% growth. And in 2019, as I said, we realized 975 billion. And as I already said, in 2020, we are past the 1 trillion mark. That is very indeed positive to us, and it is giving us hope.
One of the things that has happened with you at the helm of the insurance sector has been bank selling policies. How has this worked out, and how has it contributed to the growth of the sector?
Indeed, bank selling insurance, which we call bank assurance, has been a very good addition to our way of doing insurance in Uganda. You may need to note that the first year of our licensing banks to do it, premiums totaling to about 25 billion were underwritten. And in 2019, premiums in excess of 50 billion were underwritten through banks. We hope that when we get the figures for 2020, we are hoping that it can even go to either 80 or more than that in premiums which are underwritten through the banks.
Still talking about the portfolio of the insurance business, what is your projection in the next 10 years?
In the next 10 years, first of all, we expect that many things will have changed in the insurance industry, because we overhauled our Insurance Act, and the intention was to make sure that we address the concerns of the day. We are now on risk-based supervision, and I hope in this year we are already rolling it out. We have the regulations which are already out, and the risk-based supervision really is a transformation of
our... Maybe you should help us explain what this terminology is. What is risk-based supervision?
Okay, risk-based supervision means that as a supervisor, we look at where the risk lies most, simply put. And what also the insurance companies do, they deploy their capital where they gain much mileage. And in this, it means that a company cannot go under, should not go under, should not become insolvent if it has been monitored effectively. And by the close of this year, we are going also to deploy, we are buying a regulatory software which is going to help us to monitor companies on at every time. If any insurance companies, any insurance company underwrites any business, immediately we measure its capacity, and we can know that this company is in problems or this company is okay and it can continue for some time. In the 10 years, we expect as the regulator to have moved to our home. We, as you may be aware, we are putting up our headquarters at Plot 6, Lumumba Avenue, and we have a 12-storied building, which we expect to go to by the mid of this year. And that is going to help the capacity of the regulator. In the 10 years, we expect to see more mergers of insurance companies. And mergers, I mean, some of the existing companies will come together. They will consolidate to make sure that their capital is bigger and they can underwrite bigger projects. You may also be aware that oil and gas in the next 10 years will be here, hopefully. And the industry and the regulator, we have made sure that we get ready for that. A consortium has been created, and we hope that in the next 10 years we should be looking at bigger volumes of underwritten premiums. We should be looking at the insurance industry giving more jobs to the Ugandans. We should be looking at the insurance industry paying more taxes to government. We should be looking at the insurance industry taking its rightful position of leading the financial sector in Uganda.
You talked of mechanisms that help to supervise the industry to ensure that companies do not go under. In the banking sector, the confidence of the clientele is that there is what I think they call the Depositors Protection Fund. And so in case you've supervised and there is no way out, the company has to go under. What happens in the case of insurance? Do people lose their money? What exactly happens?
Okay, thank you very much. When the unfortunate happens in insurance, we already catered for that. We have what we call the Policyholders Compensation Fund. And this Policyholders Compensation Fund is going to be launched soon by the Minister of Finance, and the regulations have already been made. When the Minister operationalizes that fund, it means that any policyholder who may be found in the unfortunate incident that an insurance company has gone under, he will definitely run to the policyholders' compensation fund. But it is not only that. Actually, there is what we call the security deposit. We require each licensed player to have a security deposit, and this money is put in government instruments. It's put in treasury bills and many other instruments of that nature. If any company is to go under, the regulator, anybody can come to the regulator and we invoke our powers and get that money and we pay out to any policyholder. You may also need to note that even though there has been the economic meltdown, the depression and other things like that, the insurance industry has remained resilient because of the way we have structured it. And I want to assure all policyholders that majorly nothing can happen to your policies if you have insured and there is any problem which happens to the insurance company. The regulator will take charge, and the Insurance Act gives us a lot of powers to make sure that we make good whoever may be affected. And for motor third party, you may also need to know that we have submitted to the Ministry of Finance another bill to overhaul the motor third party. Many people have been complaining, and rightly so.
That's where I was going.
And rightly so, that they do not benefit from the existing motor third party. Indeed, you may realize that the Motor Third Party Act was made in 1989, when we had just gone through the economic revaluation, and money then was strong. But what we have realized is that money now has lost meaning, and in the new bill, many things are going to change.
But talking about the motor third party insurance, in the interim as we wait for amendment of the bill, what can clients, what can do to ensure that they benefit from motor third party? Because you've rightly agreed that they are very complaints about the insurance, but what can they do in the interim?
What they can do is, first of all, what we have done is to make sure that we make it easy for them to pay. And we have launched a platform with the Uganda Revenue Authority and Uganda Insurers Association and a consultant to help curb out fraud. Many of the people were buying policies which are made at NASA Road, as you know, the problems of that, and those were forged stickers. What we have now done is to make sure that we make it hard for anybody to forge any sticker. And that is going to help people that if your car is involved in an accident, at least you are assured that there will be payment. But two, I want to interest members to not only buy the statutory third party, but buy with improved limits, because the statutory third party says that if a person dies, the maximum he can get is 1 million. And the aggregate overall for the entire vehicle, even if it is a 14-seater or a bus for that matter, which sits 64 people, you cannot get more than 10 millions. And that is too little money if you put it at individual level. And what we want to encourage is that whoever owns a car, whoever owns a motorbike, whoever owns a bus, please buy third party with improved risks, improved limits. And two, also buy insurance for your driver, for your worker, because the statutory third party excludes the driver and the conductor. But it is important that when they get a problem, they should also be compensated for. Also buy insurance which has a third party extension. There is what we call third party property damage extension. And this means that when your car is involved in an accident, and maybe it has hit another car, the people who are in the car will be paid, and the vehicle which you damaged will also be paid. And that, in the meantime, can help us to move.
Alhaj, you're talking about the people in the car. How about me, the pedestrian, who the car has found by the pavement?
Actually, even you, what the statutory third party is doing, it talks of anybody who is not related to either the owner of the vehicle or is not related to insurance company which is providing this third party. If you are any of those, even if it's a neighbor who gave you a lift, you are entitled to be paid. Even if you are knocked as you are walking your journey, you should be also paid.
But moving on, there have been reports that there are insurance companies that have folded. I think one in the most recent times. What have been the implications of this on the sector?
First of all, what I want to say is that in Uganda, we have made the insurance industry as liberal as possible. And it is okay for anybody to come and you get in, you are licensed, and you start doing insurance, provided you have gone through all the requisite structures. Also, we have made it easy for any company to exit in case they so wish. You may need to note that maybe those who are exiting, they are exiting for personal reasons, but it has been proved beyond reasonable doubt that the insurance industry in Uganda is the most profitable. And so that has attracted the big players to Uganda. What I can say is that anybody can move out as he so wishes, but we have also seen many international players, and indeed the local players are participating actively in the insurance industry.
What makes Uganda's insurance industry profitable? Is it the possibility of the companies to be able to manipulate their clientele and make off a profit, or is it the enlisting of the growth of the portfolio in terms of enlisting a clientele?
It is first of all the opportunities which are here. There are many and untapped yet. So whoever comes and taps into those opportunities will definitely make many new clients. And when you enroll more clients, it means you are able to make profits. But most importantly, the regulator in Uganda has also been recognized as one of the Ugandan insurance industry has been also recognized as one of the most regulated. And when you have the regulator now making sure that you work within the guidelines which are given, you are bound to make profits. And also we have made sure that when there are big projects like you see the roads, the dams and many other things, those big government projects, you must exhaust local capacity before you offload anything outside Uganda.
You can go.
So that has made the players who come to Uganda assured of the business, but also we have been responsive, and our open door policy has helped us to hold discussions with the players, and we have come up with the solutions which were not there before And all that contributes to profitability.
You've probably come across the question quite a number of times in the media, but I'll not hesitate to ask, how has COVID-19 affected insurance in Uganda?
COVID-19 has affected us in both ways. And true, COVID-19 hit everybody hard. And indeed, COVID-19 has made many of the people who are in the production sector to slow down. Definitely, when anybody slows down, it means that even the one who would want insurance slows down. So the demand for insurance would come down. And we have also seen that the slowing down has also led to business interruption claims. You may need to note that there is a policy which is called business interruption, and people can claim on that. COVID-19 has exposed many more people to getting sick and going to hospitals. The insurance industry in Uganda agreed with us to cover COVID-19. Though it is a pandemic, they extended their medical covers to cover COVID-19. So more claims have come up as a result of COVID-19. And definitely COVID-19 has also hit us as the regulator, that we are now restricted. Our movements are restricted. So we cannot do the public awareness campaigns which we had planned to do. We cannot do the inspections as we used to do, and many other things. However, on the positive side of COVID-19, it has taught us some good lessons. One, it has taught us that not everything needs to be done when you are physically present at a site. There are many virtual interventions which you can do in order for life to move on. It has also taught us, as the insurance industry, that people need to insure more. They are exposed to many risks which they haven't insured. You may need to know that when COVID-19 started here, the president launched a team.
I'll cut you short. Let's go for a very short break. We shall return on that point.